Well, first of all, around sexuality.
首先关于性的话。
Sexuality is part of the human condition.
性是这个 人类这个 状态当中的很自然的一部分。
And for years, when people talk about sexuality and spirituality,
当这很多年以来，当人们谈到这个性和这个灵性这两者之间的时候，
they can talk about it in terms of it being good or bad or abstaining from it or practicing it.
就很多时候就人们会说这个性是好的或是不好的，或你要这个不要有性生活，或者是你要练习怎么样过性生活。
For example, in India, they have the Kama Sutra, and basically they make a science out of sexuality.
在印度有一部叫做爱经，爱经，然后他们就是专门研究这个新的理论，性的理论。
Yeah. And in many monasteries or convents, it's sexuality is something to be avoided completely.
在很多这个修道院里面的话，就在那里是不允许过任何的性生活的。
One thing you know is that the spirit will work with you in a very practical way.
但是你需要知道一点，就是灵性它会以一种非常实际的方式来修正你的头脑，去修正你的心灵。
It would be very rare for the spirit to ask you to avoid all sexuality if you still had sexual feelings.
如果你心里面还是有很多对性还有很多欲望的话，就是灵性或圣灵他很少会要你完全的弃绝性，完全的放下性。
Because if you had sexual feelings and desires and you would try to avoid sexuality and behavior, you would get into repression and denial.
就如果 你心里面有很多这个关于性的这个欲望或感受的话，然后你完全的这个避免过性生活，这样的话事实上你会进入一个压抑和否认的一个状态当中去。
And it's not really a matter of sexual indulgence in the sense that you don't, just by indulging in sex, the desire will not go away.
然后从另外一方面来说的话，我们也不应该这个沉溺在这个性生活当中去。有些人可能会认为说，你只要完全的沉溺于性生活，然后最后你可以超越它，但事实上，就你的性欲是不会因此而消失的。
So we could say that all basic human needs relate to the ego belief in lack.
我们可以说就是跟我们小我的匮乏信念有关的，有小我的匮乏信念所产生的所有各种基本的人类需求。
And through acting in a behavioral way to try to relieve the lack, it always works only on a temporary basis.
然后就只是试图这个外在的行为上的一种方式，然后来去消除这种匮乏感的话，那这种方式只会暂时有效，不会一直有效。
So spirituality is about working with your thoughts and your beliefs.
所以我们灵修的过程的话，就是我们要修正自己的念头和信念。
And it's about giving your mind over to the spirit so that you can be guided in all aspects of your life.
然后在这个过程当中的话，我们要把自己的心灵就完全的交给圣灵，然后这样的话就圣灵就会在非常具体的在你生活当中的每一个层面指导你。
So in terms of sexuality, you might say that it can be used as part of a mental discipline.
所以关于性的话，它我们可以把它用来作为我们心灵训练的一部分。
That's what happens when you have sexuality in the context of a relationship.
这就是你在这个婚姻生活当中这个性行为。
If you have a monogamous relationship, that is in one sense a discipline for the mind.
所以如果你只是说就是一夫一妻制，然后你不搞什么外遇的话，这种方式就是对心灵来说，它本身就是一种训练，或是一种纪律，心灵的纪律。你是一夫一妻制，然后没有婚外情之类的。
Yes, in this world, fidelity requires a commitment.
而在这个世界上的话，就那种忠诚就需要我们做出一定的承诺对对方。
So if you were practicing Tai Chi or Yoga, or you had you were practicing being a vegetarian, all of these require a discipline.
就比如说你在练这个泰拳，或是练瑜伽，或是你吃素等等，这都需要一定程度的这个纪律。
So in this sense, sexuality is no different than the rest. It's just part of
discipline. 所以从这个意义上来说的话，这个性跟其他所有的事情都没什么区别，都是这种纪律的一部分。
Now, your question related directly to when you become enlightened, do you still have sex?
所以你刚刚问到，就是当一个人开悟的时候，他会不会还有性生活？
You could say that the sexual desire as well as other human desires start to fade away.
你可以说，当一个人开悟的时候，就是性欲还有其他的这个人类的欲望的话，就逐渐的在我们心灵当中消失了。
Because you become more and more filled up by the spirit.
因为你会越来越多的感觉到你的内在被灵性所充满。
So things that before seem to be needs no longer are needs.
所以你之前所需要的那些东西的话，你现在你就不再需要了。
Tonight we need a microphone that works.
今天晚上我们需要这个麦克风，不要出毛病。
But at some point we will be in the divine silence and we will no longer need microphones.
有时候我们就会处在这个神圣的静默状态当中，然后就在那种状态，我们就不需要麦克风了。
So that's the simple answer to your first question.
所以这是对你的第一个问题的简单的回答。
Your second question was about spending money on spiritual studies versus things like family needs and stuff like that.
然后你的第二问题的话，就是你比较喜欢把这个钱花在自己去上些灵性方面的课程或学习当中去，但不愿为自己的父母花钱。
Yes, in terms, you may have a deep desire to experience enlightenment that would be behind the desire to spend money in that direction.
就你之所以就花钱去学这些灵性的课程，去投资方面的学习的话，是因为你有一种想要开悟的欲望，这个背后你的欲望是想要开悟。
But if it seems that your life involves a family or duties and responsibilities,
然后如果你在生活当中 你有一个家庭，然后有各种各样的这个义务啊、责任啊需要你去尽的话，
You can remember that the ego set up the whole life in this world, the whole motion picture.
所以 你需要记住的是，这个整个世界或你整个生活里面所有的事情都是你的小我所营造出来的。
And you have to follow the guidance very carefully to be unwound from this picture or taken out of this picture.
所以你必须要非常仔细的聆听圣灵的指引，然后逐渐的从这个你本来是把自己就陷到了这个世界当中去，然后慢慢的重新这个抽离出来。
So, for example, if you have some duties and obligations, it is wise to follow the spirit and put some money towards everything that you are obligated for.
就如果你在生活当中有些很多的责任和义务的话，你需要聆听圣灵的指引，然后非常明智的就是来根据实际情况，就根据你有哪些责任和义务来分配，怎么样分配你的金钱。
It can seem like you're being asked to have a balance in your life.
就是你需要保持一种平衡。
But this balance is always approached through inner guidance.
然后这种平衡的话，总是通过聆听内在的指引来达到的。
There can be a temptation to buy a lot of spiritual books or go to a lot of workshops, spiritual workshops.
你可能会就受到这样的诱惑，就是你会去买很多这个灵性方面的书籍或资料，然后去参加很多的灵性的工作坊。
But truly, most of your advancement on the spiritual journey will come from simple practices of the principles.
但是你生活生命当中的这个 最大的灵性的进步就来自于练习简单的练习一些在练习非常简单的原则。
And so I would advise putting money and resources more towards the practice of what you're doing.
所以大卫会建议你花更多的金钱或精力去做那方面的练习。
Well, that can involve just making sure that your obligations are handled so that you can have time to devote to the spiritual practice.
所以刚刚那句话的意思就是说，你用你的金钱来这个尽到你在生活当中的各种义务和责任，然后的话让你才有时间去修炼你所选择的这个法门。
Or for example, spending money on a book that seems to be very valuable versus going to hear famous teachers and speakers.
就比如说你就去买一本书，就要这个投资就要比你去听一些这个所谓的名师他的演讲或参加他的课程可能要更有价值，或者是更明智。
Yes, For me, when I first purchased A Course in Miracles, I thought it was a pretty expensive book.
对大卫来说的话，他当时买奇克那本书的时候，他觉得那本书很贵。
But then when I was reading it, I could see it was really asking me to practice, to do a lot of practice.
然后当他开始读奇克这本书的时候，是他就会开始看到，像奇克要求他真正的去操练上面的观念。
It was money well spent.
所以这个钱就花得很值。